Everybody, this is Snuck, and it's Christmas Eve night. I'm going to be recording this for Christmas Day. Just got back after a wonderful dinner with my husband and my father-in-law. We got him out. Yeah. And now I have my onesie on. And I live in a 100-year-old house. It's always cold in here. And my husband is supposed to be being quiet in the other room, and so we'll see how this goes. I'm going to read a story. It's a three-part weekend free write that I did. And it's called George and Mabel. And, oh, you're already on. Here we go. George and Mabel's story. I put the tulips under the pillows and then set fire to the house. It was what she would have wanted. She loved tulips more than anything on this earth. They reminded her of spring and new beginnings. She loved all the soft colors of tulips, even if she had the darkest of days. When she came back from the garden after seeing the thousands of tulips she had planted over the years, she would have a smile on her face. It was time to start moving on after the death of Mabel. This was the only way George could find to let go. He needed to let go of all of her, or his life would end also. He had things he had put on hold in his life, things to finish before it was time to sleep with Mabel. He took one last look at the house, wiped the last of the tears he had promised he wouldn't shed, and turned and walked to his vehicle. He took a deep breath and closed his eyes after he was seated in the buggy. His promise not to cry was going to be the hardest promise he ever kept. I cheated on my spouse, and it wasn't the first time. Mabel was, at the best of times, hard to live with. That didn't mean I didn't love her, but sometimes I needed the peace other women could give me. There was no love for the other woman, just quiet, peace for a bit. And it was just about me. Mabel had many bad days, days where it took all of George's will not to scream at the woman he loved. She was slowly losing her mind, and there was nothing he could do about it but watch and pray that soon her suffering and his would be over. When they met, Mabel was the happiest of girls, always a smile on her face and a laugh in her heart. Men and women would flock to be by her side, just to bask in her happiness. The saddest thing for George was watching the woman he loved deteriorate to Loonyville. There was not a nice way of putting what happened to her. When she saw tulips once in a while, her old self would come back for a few moments of time. George sat in his chair, doing the thing he does with the newspaper every day, glancing through it all for some sign that Mabel was still alive. Over the past years, as he was writing his novel, something he wanted to do always, he had felt signs of her. George knew it couldn't be. He'd buried her. He saw the coffin. It had to be her that he had buried. When she died, the coroner came and took her away, told him she had passed. But the tulips that showed up at his door once a year on her birthday, the smell of tulips late at night when he was writing, made him wonder if he was going crazy. So every morning, he would get the newspaper and look for signs of Mabel. Mabel being Mabel when alive. It could not be a wallflower if she tried. If she was alive, she would show up somewhere, and to George, the newspaper was the easiest way to start. He then heard the door to the kitchen open. The smell of tulips wafted in. He glanced up, and there she was, older but very sane, his Mabel. His eyes got large, his breath shortened, and he could not move. Mabel looked at him, smiled, and said, "It's time, George." George slowly stood up. his knees making loud, cracking sounds as he did. He had aged well, but at the age of 96, his body had just started to wear. He moved slower and slower every day. On days when it was cold outside, his body had all but stopped working. On those days, he would wrap himself in blankets after tending the fire and spend the day with his hot water bottle and books quietly reading the day away. On those days, he missed his Mabel the most. She could make any day a party and never stood for sadness in her house. If she was still alive today, those cold days would have been filled with tea and laughter as they sat and made up stories about all the villagers around them. Those days were long gone, and now it was just him, until now. He looked at Mabel in the eye and said, "Time for what, dear?" She replied, "The party, of course. Go grab your cloak, and let's go. You don't want us to be late, do you?" George knew Mabel hated being late. Old habits came rushing back. With Mabel, it was always best to be overprepared than under. He sped as fast as he could to go grab his best cloak, wrapping it around his shoulders tightly to keep himself warm. He walked back to his Mabel and held out his hand. Mabel wound her fingers in his and turned toward the door and started walking. George then asked where the party was going to be held, and her reply was, "At our home, of course." That afternoon, the neighbors stopped over to check on George. They had been coming every afternoon for a while now to make sure he was okay. As they walked into his house, they knew something was amiss. The house was cold. The fire must have burned out late in the afternoon. They ran to the kitchen to start it back up and found George on the floor, all wrapped up in his cloak, a smile on his face, and his hand outstretched. He had finally found his Mabel again and had gone home to spend the rest of his afterlife with her, his one true love. The end. Thank you. Have a wonderful day. Bye.